So, we're live. Once again. Today is Monday, episode 92. I can't believe we're close to approaching 100. And, boy, today's episode we're going to be talking about comics, conspiracy theories. How was everyone's Thanksgiving? Mine was pretty fucked up, I guess. So, sit back, relax. We're gonna start the intro, and we'll discuss the craziness that happened of Thanksgiving. It was pretty fucked up, in my opinion. I know some people are going like, ain't that fucked up, but to me, it was pretty fucked up. So, and I'm also going to talk about this I want to talk about this one article of DC pulling the really cool cover art of The Dark Knight Returns, The Golden Child. So, here's the intro. So, DC Comics pulled. DC Comics is to keep Raphael Grandpa's cover. I guess that's how he pronounced his name. His last name's Grandpa. Grandpa. I thought it was Grandpa. I was like, shit, that's a weird fucking name. But. Of his Dark Knight Returns, The Golden Child comic, written by Frank Miller. And there's so many fucking ads. The cover is really cool. I have to admit, it's very Miller-esque, I have to say. But it's done by a different artist. Grandpa. So many people have weird fucking names. Of course, I have one. So, anyway. I'm posting a story on Instagram. Yeah, it just started. That's okay, love. I just started it. I haven't really. No, that's alright. I haven't said anything, really. I'm just posting stories to the word out for listeners to see. Anyway. They're keeping the cover of it. I really like the cover. It's Carrie Kelly dressed as Batgirl or Batwoman. Oh, she's Batwoman. And she's throwing a Monica cocktail, which is basically gasoline or, well, lighter fluid or kerosene in a bottle, and they light a cloth. Basically, they put it in a bottle and they light the cloth, and it's dipped in like gasoline or kerosene or whatever arsenal liquid, and they throw it and poof, like a, you know, fireball thing. But the cover is really cool. I think, and the backwards, the words in the back of the, you know, Batwoman is the future is young, and a lot of people are upset over it because of the protest that's happening in Hong Kong and stuff. Hong Kong activists and stuff. I don't see the problem with the cover, to be quite honest with you. I think it's a really thought-provoking cover. And I feel like a lot of people are very tender, is the word I'm going to use. Because people are so sensitive to things. And for me, I think it's a amazing looking cover. The book's going to be out December 11th of 2019. I am definitely going to buy it because I kind of want to read it. You know, for me, in my opinion, because anything with Frank Miller attached to it, I have to read. So, anyway, how was your Thanksgiving? Okay. My Thanksgiving, I want to point this out. I usually don't talk about myself on the show, but I kind of want to. I want to talk about Thanksgiving, and it's not like the song Thanksgiving, which is fucking disturbing and creepy, but my Thanksgiving was honestly kind of the worst Thanksgiving I have ever had in my life, because I mean, I'll admit, my oldest sister's Thanksgiving was weird. Seeing my niece's husband lay all over and flirt with her stepsister. Fucking weird. And I don't get this dude. Like, he thinks of himself as, like, Casanova, that every woman wants him. But he is the ugliest looking motherfucker on the planet. He looks like somebody that, you know, watched Jerry Springer while making love, and bam, they created this thing. So, it's okay. I'm just going to rant, and I'm going to move on from it, because I have to. And I went to my other sister's place for Thanksgiving. It ended with her and her husband arguing. I don't know what the fuck about, but I don't really know. I don't want to know. Then I was looking forward to going to my grandma's house for Thanksgiving, because my grandpa makes the best turkey ever. Like, I was looking forward to this. It's like, I had the shit bird the first Thanksgiving. The second one was good. First timer's luck. Bit moist. And I was looking forward to the supreme turkey, the best turkey on the planet. Nope. Instead, I moved a fucking couch. Which, it isn't a bad couch. It's a nice couch. I mean, I figured out why they were getting rid of the couch, because my grandpa was going to buy my grandma a brand new recliner that heated seating, electric. She can move the recliner without, you know, moving the switch thing, you know, to move and recline. Totally understood. But that couch was fucking heavy. Heavy to move. It was like a body bag to move. I never moved a body bag, by the way, so I'm just using it as a metaphor. Then, after all that, after being kind of exhausted from moving a couch, my niece decided to come out of the closet. She decided to get on Facebook and reveal to everybody that she is a lesbian. I have no problem with it. But you could just tell everybody in person instead of going on Facebook and writing the post, quote, "Yes, I am dating a woman. Yes, I am happy. And anybody's got a problem with it, say something and bring it." Here's the thing. You wanted people. Now, my niece is a grown woman. She could date whoever the fuck she wants. She could date a fucking gerbil for all she wants. I don't really care who you're in bed with, and I don't really want to know. You know, I always believe, don't ask, don't tell. Nobody ask, don't tell. I know some people are going to be homophobic, you know, saying homophobic, you know, in the comments, but this is just my opinion and my thoughts of it. You want people to accept it, then you want people, then you want to fight somebody who doesn't agree. I don't have a problem with gay people. Just don't force your shit on everybody and make everybody accept it. That's my thoughts of it. So, yeah. I had one good Thanksgiving turkey. I didn't even get no pumpkin pie out of any of it. That's the thing that kind of bothered me, was I did not get no pumpkin pie with Cool Whip. Nothing. It was just, here's your turkey. And it was just really, you know, it was kind of, it wasn't a bad Thanksgiving, but it's just like, everybody's like, I can't wait for Christmas, man. We're going to get ham. I'm just thinking like, oh, fuck. I don't like ham. I'm one of those people, I just, when it comes to Christmas dinner, I just rather starve. I rather starve and wait on my birthday, because, you know, my birthday, somebody buys me something out to eat. Last year it was Taco Bell, which wasn't bad. Originally it was supposed to be Chick-fil-A, but I was just like, fuck Chick-fil-A on that one. I do not want any of their shit. If I had to choose somewhere to go out to eat, I'd rather go to fucking Culver's. I'll just buy a chicken sandwich there. But really, I don't know what I'm doing on my birthday. My birthday, by the way, is the 26th, and I know you, I think it's on Thursday. Usually I'd be doing a show on Thursday, but that day I am not doing anything, so I'm not doing a show on Thursday, so on the 26th. So anyway, what is the next article we're going to be doing? I want to read this one, this article coming up. New Line, there's reports that Wes Craven's estate is accepting a new Freddy Krueger film and TV pitches. I am not the biggest horror movie aficionado, but I seen the last Nightmare on Elm film that they did with Michael Bay producing and had Jackie Earle Haley playing Freddy. And it wasn't really bad film, but it was just really boring. I like this one. The last, Freddy film I enjoyed was Freddy vs. Jason. That was not a bad movie. I mean, Robert Englund is very scary person with and without the makeup. He is a very scary person. Like, he reminds me of, like, Michael Keaton. Like they look old, but they will fuck you up on sight. They will, like... And I just sort of, like, laughed at, I remember Robert Englund just sort of was on the Goldbergs as Freddy Krueger. And he still has it. Like, I mean, he still has it. He can still do one more Nightmare on Elm film and go out with a bang. But they keep bringing in, like, at one point I read, like, there was talks of Kevin Bacon playing Freddy Krueger. Which I could see. I mean, they don't even need the makeup and all that. I mean, Kevin Bacon is a creepy person. He's one of those people that I would not trust any kids around him. Because he's a creepy person. Kevin Bacon is a creepy person. Even when he smiles, it's like a Joker smile. When he smiles, it looks painful. It looks like his face is like, stretching. Like he's forcing that smile. That creepy smile. I could see him playing Freddy Krueger. I mean, they don't even have to put the mask and makeup or whatever special effects things they have to put on him. They could just make that film, and he would look fine in it. Just put the hat on him, you're good. He's a creepy person. He is very creepy. So, I don't even like Dirty Dancing. I know, not he wasn't in Dirty Dancing, he was in Footloose. Dirty Dancing's fine, Swayze's cool. Footloose was stupid. fans are petitioning to have Danny DeVito play Wolverine in the MCU. Yeah, I am surprised that nobody has not gotten Danny DeVito to do anything in the MCU. Like, I always thought that he could play Rocket Raccoon. Like, he could do the voice of Rocket. After, like, watching him in It's Always Sunny in Philadelphia. Like, I always thought he would be perfect as the voice of Rocket Raccoon. I know there's a lot of people who like, what's his name? Bradley Cooper doing the voice. I always thought Danny DeVito would be perfect. Because he has that voice that stands out. Like, he played the Penguin in Batman Returns, which is, like, my favorite Batman live-action film. I know there's some people who are like, what about Dark Knight? It's like, I love Batman Returns. Batman Returns is like one of those gems in movies. Like the rare film. Like it's the best Christmas film around. Fuck, It's a Wonderful Life. Batman Returns is the shit right there, man. Would I like to see him play, Wolverine? I think he'd be great. Like, he would be, God, he would be great in it. Like, he would just, come up with something and make it great. Like, Batman Returns is everyone's favorite film. I agree. It's a great film. I think it's one of those films that a lot of people sort of overlooked. Like, I remember this funny I gotta find this funny interview. This TV show, this talk show, it was like the Phil Donahue show. Like, I forget what the fuck it was called. It's like the Phil Donahue meets Oprah meets Montel Williams. Like, I gotta find it. I gotta play this one clip. During the break from the show, I was watching Psychics. Like, someone made this Sylvia Brown. Like, for those who don't know who Sylvia Brown is, she is a fucking kooky person. I mean, she was a fraud. For anyone who goes to a psychic for anything, you don't deserve money. You don't deserve to have a paycheck. If you're going to the psychic, I'm going to take my money. Where are you taking your $200? I'm going to go see a psychic. You don't deserve it. And I always wonder, like, do psychics really have the powers that they say to do? Like, they can see the future? It's like, I would love to go to a psychic and punch them and be like, did you see that in the future? It's just, I always wanted to see that, but, you know. So, I gotta hook up the speakers and stuff. I had to update my computer, which was fucking dumb. I was looking at computers today. I was like, I found like this new iPad, which I record the show on my current iPad, and I'm thinking like, shit, that'd be so awesome. Like, get an iPad and record the show. You know, do what I can. But, anyway, I'll be right back real quick. I'm going to hook up the speakers to my laptop. I'm going to play a song real quick while I do it real quick. I'm gonna play this one. I was watching that one show, the Canadian comedy show called Corner Gas. I really like that show. It's on the Internet Movie Database for those who are kind of curious and seeing what the show is about.
There's not a lot going on, but look closer, baby, you're so wrong. I roll my eyes back into my happy place. I'm always gonna need this sense of space. And in the ever wave under a rolling cloud, I can't hear what you say, cause you're talking so loud.
So, this one's pretty funny. I got this like weird message yesterday. I forgot to tell the story. Yesterday, I got, like, these weird messages blowing up my phone. It was on Twitter. And, like, it was the honest messages. I was watching the Sylvia Brown videos. And all of a sudden, I got this message from this person. Let me look it up. Because I kept... I'd blocked the person, but I kept the messages just to, like, look at, sort of laugh. The messages came from at one, what does it say? It's from a Kyle Rodriguez. And the funny thing about it is the photo of the person is a Freddie Prinze Sr. I sort of laughed at him, like, that's Chico from Chico and the Man. For those who don't get that reference, it's a TV show. Hello, my name is Kyle, and I am the assistant to Harley Quinn Leto. I'm thinking, like, oh, shit. Crazy chick is back. I think it's a chick. I don't know. Mrs. Leto wants a sit-down interview with your podcast. And I sort of sat there, like, looking at these messages, and I just look, I'm thinking, like, a fucking dude. And I responded by saying, I don't do interviews on my podcast. This isn't like the Joe Rogan Experience. And if there's only one person, I wrote this, if there's only one person I would ever do an interview with on the podcast, would be Sir Derek Jacobi, who is, for those who don't know, Derek Jacobi is a brilliant theater, TV, film actor. And the person respond to this when I said that is, who's that? And I wrote a response, Derek Jacobi or Joe Rogan? The person responds, I know who Joe Rogan is, but who the F is Derek Jacobi? They couldn't say the word fuck, so I guess they couldn't pronounce that. I wrote, you are a fucking twat. Derek Jacobi is the most highly respected, critically acclaimed actor, more successful than Jared Leto. And the person wrote, Jared Leto made a lot more money than Derek Jacobi. I wrote in response, money is a materialistic thing that does not matter. Art matters. Sir Derek Jacobi is a brilliant Shakespeare actor from Great Britain. Jared Leto is a fucking twig twat. That's pretty much what I wrote in response. And I blocked them. I don't put up with people's shit anymore. And that is one I do not put up with. So, Derek Jacobi would be like the one actor I would love to interview. Because he's a brilliant actor. Like, he said it best once in an interview with Oxford University. And he said, TV brings fame. Hollywood brings money. Theater acting brings culture. And culture is a great thing. So, I just always thought that is like the one thing that always stood out to me, what he said. Because there's a lot of videos, I think you can find on YouTube, where he does theater acting. And when you see him between film, TV, and theater, he is totally different with theater. With theater, it's very raw. It's very in the moment. Acting in TV and film, you get, like, you know, rehearsals, and you get different takes. But with theater, is just you get to see the raw human emotion, bringing words and movement to life. So I think for me, that's what I like about Derek Jacobi, is that, yeah. So I found the Sylvia Brown moments on Montel Williams. And I sometimes wonder, I wanted to do this because it's fun, because I always find people who go to psychics, like, really fascinating. It's really interesting. I swear I could pass as a psychic. I could just say something and... Because psychics are basically people who... what is the word for it? They're more like a mentalist. I mean, I wouldn't say mentalist, because Sylvia Brown is just guessing farts out of the wind. But she's basically like, you know what? I'm going to let the words of her say it. Let's play this shit. This person put together this amazing video. She claims to be the number one psychic in the world. Anyone who claims to be the number one psychic in the world is like saying you're the number one shitter in the world. I shit bigger than you, is basically what she's saying to other psychics. So, anyway, she goes to these parents, and she sits there trying to look mysterious, wearing different rings and jewelry and necklaces. Trying to look like I am the most, the most superior person in the room, and I know all the answers. I don't know what that means. So, here's the thing. Sylvia Brown, I'm going to put this out there. I know there's going to be some people who are going to be upset about it, especially on YouTube. YouTube is going to be upset about it, but here's the thing. My channel is demographic to adults, not kids. So, kids should never repeat anything I say, because I am a unfiltered person. But Sylvia Brown is a fucking cunt. She goes after the most vulnerable people in the world. My dog just barks, so she agrees. By the way, I bought my dog Batman stuff for Christmas. I bought Stitch a dog collar, a Batman dog collar that says the Cape Crusader. It didn't fit him. But he has a Batman dog collar, which is really cool. I just cleaned it today, so I had to, like, clean it up and stuff. So I gave the new collar to Lilo. And she's just, like, strutting around, like, walking, like, check it out. And I gave I gave Lilo's bandana to Stitch. So Stitch is wearing, like, the bandana that looks more like a cape. Lola got a Catwoman toy. She could play with it, but she mostly uses it as a pillow. And Lilo has, like, this Batman dog toy that she carries with her. She carried it to the bed and just, like, laid on it, like, holding it, like... So, anyway, That's why I got them for Christmas, and I ended up buying my dad for Christmas a record crate thing. He collects vinyl records. Like, he has the complete collection to, what is it, that one show? It was the one with David Cassidy and Bonaducci on, Partridge Family. The complete Partridge Family records. Donnie Marie Osmond. Don't know why. So, I ended up buying him that, and I bought my mom a hoodie that exactly looks like her hoodie that got destroyed in a washer. So, that's what I got them for Christmas. And my dad ended up buying me a Batman Returns shirt in Japanese writing. So, that's it. That's what I got for Christmas. Which I'm fine with it. Like, I am not a materialistic person. I don't really care. but it's cool. Anyway, let's play Sylvia Brown. By the way, she's dead, for those who don't know. I guess she did not know when she was going to die. I thought she was a psychic. So, anyway.
You got a question for Sylvia about your daughter, Michelle?
Michael, let her. Michelle was 17 years old. She'll be gone 5 years, the 21st of this year. Sylvia, I don't know how she died. Please, if you can, how did she die?
She was shot. Circumstances around her death?
She just collapsed in her room.
I don't know, but something looks like it hit the chest.
So their daughter tragically died. She collapsed in her room. But according to Sylvia Brown, she was shot. Even though she collapsed in her room, she was shot. The parents' reaction to this when she said it, that she was shot, they just look like, the fuck? Especially the dad. The dad had to look of like, what the fuck? It's kind of like a South Park moment. And South Park did an episode mocking psychics. But Sylvia Brown believes the daughter was shot. So, I don't know how this woman got shot, but apparently she was shot, but she collapsed in her room, according to the parents.
Because it looked like
they found nothing on the autopsy.
I don't care, nothing. But it looks like something hit her in the chest.
They did an autopsy, they did drugs, you know, they do whatever
everything.
They do. It's just she was a healthy child and
just
fell out in her
just
room.
Just went
fell
out.
Like a golf club's fall or whatever.
I know, just went down.
Yeah.
I don't know, but there was something that hit her in the chest, I'm telling you.
They did an autopsy. An autopsy is the most 100% confirmed cause of death. An autopsy, which they will open up the body, check the organs, find something, do blood work, everything, toxicology, all that. But Sylvia Brown believes this woman was shot. Now, if I ever die, hypothetically, because I plan to outlive everybody I know. I would not want any psychic to be like, he died this way. But the whole cringe of this. Now, I take over. What? It's a joke, by the way. It's a joke. I would not want a psychic to give a final cause of death of how I died. That is just the way I don't want. I don't want no psychic at my funeral. But anyway, I mean, I don't believe in psychics. It's a joke. My funeral's gonna be epic. I wanna go out the Viking way. Put all my stuff and valuables on a boat. Just the Viking way. Just roll me out to sea. By the way, that's a joke too, so. But this whole psychic thing is just so bad. Like, not John Edwards bad. John Edward bad. I was going to say Edwards, but we all know how his campaign went. Had an affair on his dying wife, knocked up the chick, and denied it. I wonder whatever happened to him. But anyway. And Montel Williams tries to save Sylvia's blundering ass over this. There's no way.
You know something sharp.
Did she play sports?
Yes.
Could she have, there have been, in this last year alone, there have been two young men who have come home from baseball practice,
yeah,
having been struck in the chest earlier and died, and there was no bruising.
That's
that.
Right, yeah.
So, I don't,
was she any place before this that she was, could have been hit?
Possibly, but I'm not.
Because it seems like it was almost like a shot.
That was bad. The father of the daughter looked annoyed. Like, he looked mad. And you really couldn't blame him. You really couldn't blame him because he's going with facts. Fact. They did an autopsy. Fact. She died mysteriously for unknown circumstances or reason. Fact. She played sports. I mean, she could have had, like, a cardiac arrest unexpectedly out of nowhere, or an aneurysm or something. I mean, shit. She could have had a heart attack. That's what could have happened. But Sylvia Brown believes this woman was shot. And Montel Williams tries to save her fake blundering ass by going like, well, you know, did she play sports? Did she play sports? She could have got hit in the chest or something right there. I'm going with the autopsy that this woman, this poor woman, died unexplained and mysteriously. So it bothers me that this Sylvia Brown is just crazy. So anyway, let's see what she does now.
I lost my boyfriend tragically a few years ago. They never found him. And I've had such a hard time since. Every day.
The reason why you didn't find him is because he's in water. And to find him in water, it's like the girl that's missing in Aruba. You can't find somebody.
Well, it was September 11th. There was no... He was a fireman, but...
Well, no. See, I keep seeing him in water.
This woman is an idiot. Her boyfriend was a fireman. September 11th. We all know what happened that sad day. But according to Sylvia Brown, he was in water. Ugh, this woman is a fucking fake. He was a fireman. Does Sylvia Brown know where she was at that day? In New York? What happened? This woman is a fucking fake. And I'm glad that Montel Williams is no longer on the show, because he would have brought somebody else in, like, to be the next psychic. And it's sad enough, I used to watch the show. It's sad enough. I used to watch this show and just watch this woman be dumb as hell on this show. And throughout this whole time, Montel Williams hold on. I'm looking for like this ridiculous thing. I want to find this most ridiculous thing ever. Oh, fuck, YouTube. Nobody cares about this whole... Which laptop are you considering buying? Have they been listening to my conversation? I am not buying any laptop right now at the moment. It's creepy as shit, I mean. Have you ever had, like, you go to a store... I have to ask this question for the listeners. Has anybody ever gone to a store... And all of a sudden, your phone, ding, asks you how was the store that you went to? Has anybody ever been on there? Just the question, like, has anybody ever had that, like, that moment? Like, my phone, I mean, my phone never done it. Because if it did, I'd be like, sir, you're going out the fucking window. But it is so weird, though. Usually, it happens to, I don't know, it usually happens to, like, some people talked about having, like, their phone all of a sudden, like, know where they went, which store they went into, and how was that store. Like, it is, like, creepy stuff to see, like. I'm just, like, looking at this. Alright, here it is. This is some... Alright, We had Montel having Sylvia Brown, and he had to compete against Mari. Because Mari was the show where it was at. Like, Mari was getting huge ratings, over, especially over this stuff. See, Mari had a badass kid. He was 7 years old, smoking weed. Like, I was a badass motherfucker. See, Montel Williams couldn't handle that. Montel could not handle badass kids like that. I mean, even if he had a psychic with you. Like, I don't know where the hell Mari done this. I don't know where the hell he got these kids. These are, this is fucking stupid. Ah, shit. This is just it's just I don't know what to react to this, because I mean, you have a 7-year-old kid on Mari talking about his favorite drink is whiskey. It's just, I don't know what to react to this, because it's just like the kid doesn't even look like he, I mean, the kid looks like he still watches Elmo and Friends, so it's just, what, does he have, like, a little fake, little toy set? Where he has all his stuff, you know, toys sitting in chairs and they're doing reenactment of Cheers or something? And he comes in, sits in the chair, and there's Buzz Lightyear behind the bar. Going like, oh, Buzz, I had to do math. 2 + 2. You find out it's 4. And the dodgeball game was brutal. So he goes like, I'll take an apple juice. The apple juice is like in a little shot glass. He drinks the apple juice and goes, ah, we had to do subtractions now. So my dog's barking. By the way, I got to tell this one. My neighbors, my crazy, loud-ass neighbors. I don't know which episode it was. I did an episode where I played, like, Snapchat recordings of them. Like, they were so fucking loud that time when I recorded it that it was just, like, it was ridiculous. I couldn't even hear my TV. So, anyway, they got into a fight on Thanksgiving. Yeah, so. Anyway. Let's get to the Phantoms and Monsters thing. I've been meaning to get to it. So, anyway. Let me find. Let's see what they have under the labels of bizarre. I had to burp. See what the yeah, I'm just reading a Twitter message. I'm just looking up stories and articles that seem interesting, so bear with me. I got a question right here. Forever. Oh, this is a question. Would you ever consider doing a YouTube series investigating weird and bizarre strange things? Yeah. I mean, I know New Year's 2020 of the show, I am going to attempt to do a first ever YouTube video where you can, I guess, see me, unfortunately. You're probably going to need bleach for your eyes afterwards, but yeah, I kind of want to do like more YouTube things. I mean, I enjoyed doing the podcast and stuff, and I think I still will do like, you know, videos while doing the podcast. You know, I really want to do more cool stuff for, you know, the show and stuff. So, yeah, I mean, YouTube channel will grow. I would love to try uploading videos on StoryFire, if I ever could, but I think they're still in the early stages of being a full-time video streaming thing. I don't know. I mean, I know there's some people who kind of make accusations that StoryFire is mostly created for other, you know, creators that are friends with Mick Jagger Nuggets. I don't know if it's true or not. I don't think it will. I mean, there are people who want to create content and create new stuff. So, you know, I'd love to create, you know, cool videos and stuff. I mean, who wouldn't want to create videos and stuff, so. You know, so. Yeah, I mean, I can't wait to create videos and stuff. I mean, I'm a fan of, like, I know YouTube right now, they're having a lot of weird stuff that's happening at the moment. You know, like going after content creators that really make a living off of doing YouTube and stuff. I mean, YouTube is a great platform for people who want to, you know, what is the word for it? Like, they want to, you know, they want to be content creators. I mean, if you look at some of the stuff, like, YouTube sort of plays favoritisms at times. I believe it's true. I mean, I never seen Will Smith's channel blow up so fucking huge, and he creates, like, the most boring videos. I'm sorry, I know there's people who love Will Smith, but the dude creates boring videos. I'm sorry. It's like, I don't really fucking care what happens behind the scenes of the next Bad Boys film or Aladdin or whatever he's doing. I mean, Will Smith kind of reminds me of that weird, you know, weird dad who tries to, like, fit in with the hipsters. Like, the Steve Buscemi incident, like, I, you know, where he's, like, he's wearing a side cap, and he's carrying a skateboard, and he's like, what up, you know, to everybody, like, that's what it kind of reminds me of, Will Smith, you know. He's very weird. I don't know why. I know there's some people who like him, but he kind of comes off weird, like, very strange person, you know. I guess I'm still kind of, you know, aggravated over the Suicide Squad. I know it's not his fault, but anyway. Let's see. I'm looking at this, like, article, videos and stuff. Like, yeah, I mean, like, he's on TikTok. Like, he was on TikTok or whatever, and I seen, like, the video, like, they played on, like, Fox News of him on TikTok. It was, like, the cringiest video I have ever seen. Like, I mean, it's not cringy as, like, Corey Feldman, like, you know, the fell dog and all that. Millennial. So, I don't know how people react to it, but anyway, yeah. It's kind of, like, one of those weird... By the way, I'm looking at vampire stories, so... I would love to, like... I gotta say one thing. Like, one thing I want to do... I talked about it. Is I want to go to New Orleans. You know, New Orleans. And I want to read this one story. I gotta go back to it, by the way. This New Orleans vampire story. Let me find it. It's this... there's some interesting vampire stories. I'll get to that one. I read the story of... Now, here it is. The New Orleans Vampire Murders. In 1984, 9 people were found dead in various sections of the French quarters in New Orleans. They all had been murdered by having their throats torn out. Paramedics responding to the scenes were struck by the fact that there was no blood at the scenes. Something or someone has simply sucked all the blood directly from the victims. Police to this day do not have any suspects in the case. The murder spree ended quickly, and it began rumors suggesting that it was the works of a rogue vampire that was destroyed by the elder vampire sect of New Orleans because of the pressure placed by authorities on the known vampire community in the city. I want to go there, and I want to find, as weird as it sounds, like, I want to go there and investigate to see if this story is true. I want to do a documentary series and find out if this is a true story. And I know I could do it online and do it on the podcast, but being there in person, by going to... You're coming. You're coming along. And go to the places that many people say that where it happened, like the French quarters of New Orleans. That's a big area. That's a big area, by the way. I want to go there and see where this happened, where all these murders happened, and who were the people. And this whole rumors of an elder vampire sect of New Orleans destroying this rogue vampire I want to know where this happened. Because when I hear this, I think immediately of one or two things. I think of two movies, by the way, when I hear this. I think of one, Interview with the Vampire. Two, Gotham by Gaslight, oddly enough. Because when I think of New Orleans, I think of like this classic, like very old century area, New Orleans, for some odd reason. I want to go there and just investigate this, because, I mean, there's been rumors and stuff of vampires in St. Louis. Like, there's a vampire club. Not like a club of, like, over 30-year-olds in a basement somewhere. There is an actual vampire nightclub / bar. For people live out their fantasies of being vampires or something. I've never been there. I've heard about it from listeners here in the Show Me State telling me this. But hearing it, it's kind of weird as that sounds. Because immediately when I hear it, I think of opening the door and like a beam of light enters and all these people are wearing sparkling things on, you know, their skin. Well, if we're going there, we're going to pick up some garlic. So, I mean, for me, I want to do this sort of documentary series where going to places to investigate all these weird things. Like, Area 51 has always been on my bucket list. It used to be the Flintstones campground / park until they closed down this year. That was my dream. Going there. Love you more. I mean, that's the one thing I always wanted to go to, is that the Flintstones park. Because I love the Flintstones, by the way, for those who don't know. Anyway, I'm going to Google this. The New Orleans vampire murders. 1984. Unexplained mysteries. All right, this person wrote this. The vampire murders at a unusual convent in 1978. Hi there. I'm going to read this article, this thing this person wrote. This person, I can't even pronounce your name, dude. You know how one of those people always come up with the usernames? And they come up with like the weirdest thing. So anyway, the person wrote, hi there. This is, by the way, posted November 10th, 2012. Hi there. I was wondering if someone could, in this form, had any information about, that would be able to be, that would be able to sustain whether this is a fact or fiction. When I was on a tour in New Orleans in 2003, I remember hearing a story about two tourists that, down from a paranormal investigation in 1978, was setting up a video camera outside this unusual convent, trying to capture a glimpse of the vampires, rumored to be nailed on the third floor of this convent. The tourists, who were mostly recounts the tale, are women, are abducted, then later forced outside of St. Mary's Church, drained 80% of their blood. Their footage was found on a camera at the scene of the abduction, indicated that... Oh, that was weird. I heard... Yeah, I seen a cat under my house. I hope they're not trying to come in to vent. I put blankets out there in the shed. I know that one black cat named Romeo that I feed, because he's always at the table on my front porch looking at my cat. He's been trying to get in this house. This cat, this black cat, I do pet him, I do give him attention and love, but he's not moving in. The cat is not moving in this house. And I ain't having no kittens. Okay, I don't want no kittens in my house. Next thing you know, my bed would be full of cats all over, laying all over my bed. Anyway. I'm not making this up. Like, last night, I heard that thump, thump from the air vent. My cat Lola meowed, and all of a sudden I heard another meow, which was not my cat. I'm thinking, like, shit. Anyway, the footage of the camera, it was... He has blankets. I give him food. I brought him, you know, water. New blanket. I bought a new blanket for him. I mean, it wasn't new. I bought it at a resale shop. Which, by the way, the story was kind of crazy. I was there. And I was there buying the blankets and stuff. Like, one of them turned out to be a Snuggie. A Snuggie, which you can put your arms in. You can, like, wear the blanket. Anyway. abducted indicated a non-eventual event. And so someone knocks the camera over around 4 a.m., which happened between 4 a.m. and 7 is unknown, according to legend. Now, a couple of things that kind of strike me as odd. The only the website mentions the unsolved murders are ghosts and vampire sites. There are none online reputable sources validated this. Also, there are some the tourists of or interns for a paranormal investigation team and others. There are male and another version. I have heard that they were down for Mardi Gras and decided to test the lore as a lark. So it kind of gives the lore and legend based on some substance of the fact, which happened. And then there is anyone who knows about this, if there are actual police or coroner reports available, the substance he claims, public, blah, blah, blah. Let's see. One person, I believe you answered your own damn question. I love that. I like that one comment. Because that sounds like something my dad would say. I believe you answered your own damn question. So. I love that. That was pretty funny. Because it sounds like something my dad would say. And he's not really into the supernatural paranormal stuff. He kind of like looks at it as like, it just kind of made me laugh a bit. I was reading it. I'm like, didn't you just answer your own question? This one's pretty interesting. I'm looking at these weird sites. in Spain. That's sorry, wrong one. It's about the giant squid that washed up on Spain. I kind of find all these really interesting. This is an interesting story. A fun one. My evening at the La Dame. Kind of sounds like something out of... kind of sounds like something Donald Trump would name. La Donald Trump. by the way, I'm just cracking a joke, so... Anyway. So we hit the 70-minute mark already? Damn. I feel like I just started this show not that long ago. Anyway, I'm going to take a quick break. I will be right back. We're going to read this story, this vampire story, The Evening at the La Dame. Back in the 1980s. A lot of the weird things happened in the 80s. I don't know which song to play, so I'm gonna play this one. The Royal Concept, World on Fire. Check my phone. I love this song. Me too, it's the Royal Concept. It's a good song. It's the World on Fire by the Royal Concept. One person, how was your Black Friday? That was pretty funny though. I waited in line for Black Friday at a bookstore. And I ran late. Like, I was like dead last in line almost. I had to pick up my nieces and nephew. They want to go to Party City, which I have no problem going to Party City. I don't mind going to Party City. I mean, it was pretty cool seeing, like, one section Christmas, one section over, basically in the same entryway of the store. Once you go inside, you go further. Halloween stuff. Like, you get a bottle of blood for 50 cents. I'm like, that ain't a bad deal right there. Fake Halloween blood, 50 cents. That's a good deal. Good steal. So, it wasn't bad. I wasn't even buying anything at the store. Like, my mom was buying birthday party stuff for my great nephew's birthday. And we aren't even going to that party. Like, I'm busy that day. I'm really not, but I just didn't want to go. we're not even going to that party. Like, my parents already have plans to do something for themselves that day. Well, I guess they're going to... I think they're going to go see that Mr. Rogers movie is what they're doing. I think that's where they're going. They're going to go on a dinner date to go see Mr. Rogers biopic. And I'm basically just, I'm going to be chilling at the house. I am doing nothing that day. I am just going to relax, read a new book I bought. I bought a new book at the store. Batman versus Predator 2. That's it. That's what I'm doing that day. Because I never got to I read the first one. I just never gotten around to reading the second book. So that's what I'm doing. I am not a big birthday person. Like, a lot of people were asking me, like, you know, in my family, like, do you want a birthday party? You know, do you want to have a birthday party for you? You know, do you want to celebrate? I'm like, nope. I don't mind my birthday. Like, my birthday is the 26th of December, which I mentioned, which is a Thursday. I just don't really want to celebrate my birthday. I don't mean it in a negative way. It's just that when you have a birthday party, you have to invite people that you really don't want to be around that are in your family. And I have nothing in my family. I have no one in my family I don't like being around. It's just knowing my sisters and my nieces and nephews, they bring nothing but drama. And it's like, how is it a happy birthday when you're going to have drama in it? Like, I know, right? Like, my sister is, my oldest sister, who my niece came out as a lesbian, her mom, which is my sister, my niece, you know, stuff, isn't really in favor of this whole thing that my niece did. And there's going to be a bunch. It's really weird, though. They live in the same house together. And my sister is just like, I didn't know she was a lesbian. I was just like, how are you supposed to ask somebody what their, what ice cream they like? So I don't know what you want me to say to that. So I really don't want to hear a whole argument of lesbianism. as messed up as it is, my family is like, they're all, you know, it's crazy. And I was just like, it was funny though. I said to my dad, I'm like, I don't think I want a birthday party. And he's just like, we can still move to Florida. I'm just like, no. If I had to choose between a hurricane or this, I'd rather go with the hurricane. I take my chances. So, anyway, it was a really messed up thing. So, anyway, let's get to this My Evening at the La Dome. The following anecdote is forwarded by a reader. Hi, whoever, I guess. The La Dome restaurant is in the Sunset Strip. Back in the mid-1980s, I was in the lounge enjoying a drink with a friend. Alright. I like that plan. Near us was a striking, elegant couple was seated. They both look European. How do you know they look European? She was a stunning brunette. Her face had all the captivity feature that can get a guy in trouble. A dark red lipstick sealed the deal. I like how he just puts it that way. I mean, everything he's writing is basically sounds like an 80s novel adapted into a movie. A timeless long black evening gown graced by the contours of her remarkable body. Yep, this sounds like something out of a fucking 80s wow, chicka wow, wow type film. This was the kind of woman every leading actress in old Hollywood wanted to be. He was a blonde, strong, chiseled features, classically handsome. Some men exuded a presence, his presence. He was heroic looking, wore a black tuxedo, draped from his shoulders, with a huge matching cape, with a red ribbon near his neck. Ribbon was either some kind of ascot or attached to his shirt collar, whatever it is. Basically, he's pointing out that these people look like something out of the 1940s or 50s type film. I be honest with you, like, if I ever, I'm not making this up. I seen someone who dressed like they belong in the steampunk period. I am not making this up. I just sort of went like, I saw that it was in the store. It was in the store. It was, I was exiting the store and they were just like walking forward. And I looked at them and it was both dudes. They were wearing like a top hat, like a little glasses, you know, walking with a cane. And I mean, mind you, like it wasn't a cane, it was like a cane slash walking stick. Like they had no limping problems like most people walk with a cane. Like Dr. House, for example, from the show House. I looked at these people as like walking, I'm like, what a bunch of hipsters looking motherfuckers. Like, they look like something out of Hot Topic. Like, they look like they shop there regularly. And I just sort of was just like, man, these people are fucking weird looking. They were sitting at a small round table in the front of a charming fireplace. Above the fireplace mantle is a mirror reflecting the low glow of a few of the walls in the room. They sat on opposite of each other, separate by a lit candle placed at the center of the table. Each had a tall glass of red wine. Their postures were probably perfect. Their demeanor was stoic. These two were a mystery. It sounds like something out of a Batman novel, but the way I just read it. Selina and Bruce sat at the table. Opposite were two tall glasses of wine. Their postures were perfect. Their demeanor was stoic. The two were a mystery, but not to themselves. The bat and the cat. See, I just wrote a fucking Batman scene right there. Off the top of my head. And I narrated it, by the way, so you're welcome. So anyway, I felt that the couple was not in costume. There was no Halloween parties at the time of this year. Not amazing as you love. But I don't believe that their reasons were to be a stage theatrical for the sake of getting attention. They were simply being whoever they were. I have to admit, this story kind of remind me of Morticia and Gomez Adams, you know, from the Adams Family. I haven't seen the new movie. Like, I heard it's really good. But the way that he's describing them is that they sound like more, sort of like the modern Adams Family type thing. Like, they like being who they are. They're comfortable in their own skin. Which is basically like any vampire tale, is being comfortable in your own body of who you are as an individual. Which is the amazing thing of vampire stories and stuff. These two are just comfortable in being who they are as individuals. Like, they like being themselves. They like dressing the way they dress. They like being the way they want to be. So, for me, that's what kind of reminds me of. Intrigued by them, I often peered sneaking glances to see what they were doing. They sat and looked at each other the entire time they were there. I never saw them speak. I never saw them drink. Each glass remained completely full. They didn't gesture. Not for one moment did he or she fidgeted to get comfortable. They just didn't move at all. That was odd. I'll check to see if I have the links, alright? I look at the story as like, he's very off-putting of how these two are just... It sounds like the way he's saying is like they were both focused on each other's eyes. Like they just kept having this trance they were in. Which I think is spectacular, in my opinion. I joke that I don't believe in vampires. But if there were any, we might be seeing two of them right now. It seems silly, but I became eager to see them leave. They would have to stand up. They would be standing in front of the fireplace mirror. I truly wanted to see them. See if they had a reflection in that mirror. So I looked over at them. Even more often. Too often, I admit that I... bruise the boundary of social equity. But my curiosity trumped, but good manners. I didn't care. I just wanted to see them in front of that mirror. I didn't want to miss seeing that. Looking away for a brief moment, I looked back to see them again. Unbelievably, they were gone. And the wine glasses had vanished too. I was astonished. One can summon that the La Dame Matrid simply encountered them. Escorted them away to a dining table that somehow I was distracted and lost track of time and missed the activity. That is a rational explanation, but I truly know what happened. You see, afterwards I walked through the restaurant and see them seated at a dining table. I didn't find them. Shit, this one is pretty fucked up. Hold on. Alrighty, I want to read this one. An attack of a shape-shifting alien. Askwag or buffoonery? A UFO investigator, Blake Cousins, was researching an incident that took place in Maui, Philippines on July 13th, 2012. On Friday the 13th, an 80-year-old man named Victor was repeatedly attacked by a strange creature that was... And there was photogenic evidence of the attack. The attack was caught on video. That video has never been released to the public yet. For now, Cousins shared the several still frames of the photos from the video of the alien attack. You can read on the Examiner. It's pretty fucking creepy looking, if you ask me. I'd be honest, it looks more like a video that they wanted to make viral, in my opinion. Do I believe... I don't know. It looks... I mean, you have to really look at it yourself. I will post... try to get screenshots of it, but... Anyway... he claims that it was a vampire attack, but in 2004, a boy survives the same attack as well. But in my opinion, I do believe that it could be a bizarre attack. So anyway, I want to read this one article that I want to talk about. It's about Mauro Ranallo and WWE. I know usually when we wrap up the shows and stuff, I sort of have a joking manner about Anyway, Mara Ranallo, who is a excellent commentator for WWE, he recently had to take time away from WWE after he had what is the way to describe it? He has bipolar disorder, and I'm very familiar with bipolar disorder. I know it very well. He recently had to take time away from WWE once again. SmackDown, he was phenomenal in the commentary. And recently, back in 2017, he had to walk away from WWE due to being bullied. There was allegations of him being bullied by JBL. And he had to, walk away and recover from the incident. Because, you know, when you have, an incident like that, when you have, an incident of, dealing with something that you just, you feel like your personal space has been violated, that you just need to walk away and recover mentally, you know, and stuff. And recently, he, during the Survivor Series, had a incident where you with Corey Graves, and he had to walk away because Corey Graves made a tweet basically attacking him for talking too much. He's a commentator. What do you expect for him to do? I would say this, Mauro Ranallo is one of the best commentators today, besides Jim Ross, Tony Schiavone, for WWE. When I look at WWE, they got fucking nothing to sell. A commentator is basically someone who has to sell this match, sell these people larger than life, that would get people to get behind them, buy their merch and stuff, buy their t-shirts and all that. Mauro Ranallo is that good of a salesman, that good of a commentator. I mean, he did great for boxing, MMA, and so far WWE. And he did a fucking good job at War Games. War Games is WWE's trying to make it relevant again. I mean, I wouldn't say relevant, but it's been popular since WCW. WWE kind of makes them boring. So, Mauro Ranallo did a brilliant job with it, and Corey Graves basically wrote, "Just for note, there is a WWE Hall of Famer and a Ring of Honor champion on commentary." Shrug, you know, shoulders emoji. I like Beth Phoenix and Nigel McGuinness. Nigel McGuinness was brilliant in Ring of Honor, both as a wrestler and as a commentator, an on-screen figure. But he was boring doing commentary. I'm sorry. I don't mean this is a negative way to say it about Nigel McGuinness, but he is kind of boring at times when he's doing commentary. Beth Phoenix is great. Very underrated wrestler, in my opinion. She carried the women's division on her shoulders when there was no one around besides Natalia Hart, Neihart, and all that. But, you know, you have Mauro Ranallo. He's like the Tom Brady for the NXT commentary. And to write a tweet like that is pretty fucking disrespectful for a guy who is trying to be like Bobby Heenan and Jerry Lawler of today. So, it's kind of annoying. And I want to say this. I mean, I'm not going to say it because it'd be pointless to bring Michael Cole into this. Michael Cole is a great commentator, but damn it, I miss Booker T in commentary on SmackDown. Like, why does SmackDown have like two people and Raw has like three people? You know, I mean, AEW is doing great and, you know, and all that. But anyway, I just wanted to point this story out. I feel bad for Mauro Ranallo, and hearing that he's doing better is a good thing to hear. People with bipolar disorder, here's the thing. If you got something to say to somebody, say it to their face instead of going on fucking Twitter to write something. It's like, Corey Graves did commentary with Mauro Ranallo. You could have just said it to his face. You could have just said, you know, you're talking too much. Which is kind of dumb because he's a commentator. I mean, he's going to be talking a lot. He's not going to be like silent Stan Kroenke. That dumbass. So, anyway. So far, I mean, it's kind of aggravating, but to hear that. So, anyway, this is going to be the wrap up of the podcast. We will do more supernatural stories, I guess. There's one that really caught my eye, which is vampires, reptilians, or something. So, anyway, yeah, this is going to be the wrap up of the podcast. I will be back tomorrow. So, there's one story I kind of... Thank you, love. There's one story I kind of want to cover, which is something interesting. Tomorrow's episode, I want to talk about flying humanoids. As weird as that sounds. Can humans fly? I don't know. We're going to find out tomorrow's episode. I will do the other story that I really want to cover, that vampire reptilians thing. I've always creeped out by reptilians. They're fucking creepy, disturbing. Yeah. Anyway, I will see you all tomorrow on the podcast. I feel like this is more of a radio show than anything. So anyway, yeah. Hold on. Does this mean you're going to quit talking about Batwoman? How about the show Batwoman? Batwoman kind of sucks still. Now, Batwoman is a disaster of a show. I'm sorry. I know my niece is a lesbian, but she has to accept that Batwoman is a fucking bad show. Even though she likes the comics. The show itself is garbage. So, anyway, I will see you all tomorrow. Same bat time, same bat channel, same Josh still. So anyway, I will see you all tomorrow. Hope you all had a wonderful Thanksgiving. I kind of did. yeah. Just word of advice, never cook the innards inside the turkey. Take the innards out, everything out of the neck. Don't ever cook with all the guts and all that in the turkey. Anyway, thank you. Good night and good luck.